Hi, I'm Matthew Burchette, and this is behind the wings of the 34th annual Space Symposium in Colorado Springs. And check this out. Bam! That's Sierra Nevada's Dream Chaser. How cool is that? There are over 14,000 participants here from 30 different countries. So let's stop talking and let's start interviewing. I am here with Dr. Janet Kevon of the Glenn Research Center, and she works for NASA, has been into space, and is super cool. Thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, it's my pleasure, Matthew.
So we're standing here, and this looks like a Saturn V to me, but I know it's not because it's an SLS,
right.
Which stands for what?
Space Launch System.
So this is basically our new Saturn V.
Our new rocket, yes, that is capable of going back to the lunar vicinity, also further than that, we can actually go to Mars with this rocket as well.
Oh, no kidding.
Right.
So where is actually Orion on here?
Orion is where the crew will sit, which is up here at the top. They got the crew module and a service module, and then there's a launch abort system up there on top,
okay.
Which could carry the crew away in the event of a bad event. So at the Glenn Research Center, which is where you mentioned I work, we're working on the service module, this part underneath the crew module, that contains solar arrays and power and electronics that will support the crew module where the people will live. And then we will take it down to the Kennedy Space Center, mate it with the crew module. And then once that's mated, we will fly it up to Ohio and test it in the Plumbrook facility, which is part of the Glenn Research Center, which has the world's largest vacuum chamber. And we'll do thermal vacuum testing on it up there. And then we'll fly it back down to the Kennedy Space Center, where it will then be assembled into the full configuration for launch.
You know what? Thank you so much for your time. I know you're very busy.
Yeah, thank you.
But it was so nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you.
And hopefully we will see you maybe up in space again.
Well, I would love to, but I think we've kind of passed that off to the next generation.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. I'm here with Samantha Suarez, who's got the coolest title ever. She is the SRB integration lead for the Vulcan Centaur rocket for United Launch Alliance. Tell us a little bit about what ULA does.
Yeah, so ULA is a launch service provider. We have our Atlas and our Delta rockets that are currently flying today. But one of the things we're doing right now is, as you stated, we're developing the Vulcan Centaur rocket, which it's incredibly exciting. And like you stated, I am integrating these solid rocket boosters right here onto the vehicle. So working with our supplier to make sure that we get everything to fit with our design, and vice versa, that our design fits with their design. We're going to launch in 2020, and it's going to essentially become our one product line. Eventually we'll fly out Atlas and Delta, and we'll have Vulcan Centaur flying.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
I kind of see behind you, send your face to space, which I did, and I'm proving my wife wrong, who said that I would never make it to space.
Yeah.
And I'm getting there.
There you go.
But what is that, actually?
We took some pictures, and like you got to do, put your picture on a tile and put it on that poster. That poster is, in fact, going to go in the CST-100 Starliner capsule that's going to launch on an Atlas rocket. The very last tile was done by our CEO, Tory Bruno, so he actually took the last picture and got to put his picture on there as well.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so it's got, you know, people like you and me who can prove people wrong and say we're going to space. And then it's got our CEOs and all these people on
that
there.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
So I'm here with Justin Kugler, and he is with a company called Made in Space, and it is exactly what it sounds like. Justin, good to see you again,
buddy.
Good
to see you, man.
Let's just get right down to it. You were telling me about Arconaut,
yes.
Which is this right here, and this thing is really super getting sci-fi type stuff.
This is one concept that we have for what we call the Arconaut in-space manufacturing technology. We combine extended structure, additive manufacturing in space with robotic assembly so that we can fabricate, assemble, and deploy structures in space of, you know, arbitrary size, shape, and configuration. We can build systems and space vehicles now that are optimized for, you know, their 10 to 20 year life in space instead of that first 15 minutes just to make it through the rocket ride.
So to put that into English, this will build stuff in space.
Yes.
So we will launch this, It will then build the X-Wing or the Death Star in space, and we don't have to launch it. I know you're busy, but I just want to say thank you so much, and we
definitely
had to get this into the episode because, oh my gosh, that's cool.
Absolutely.
So when you guys do finally get that first X-Wing built, I kind of want the first ride.
I understand. We'll see what we can do.
I'm here with Tory Springer, who's the Director of Weather and Environment for Ball Aerospace. And we are standing here in front of kind of like this disco ball ironing thing, which is actually the Global Microwave Imager. What the heck is that?
Okay, that's a good question. So it was a joint program between NASA and the Japanese Space Agency. The contribution from the US and NASA was they provided the instrument, which Ball built for NASA, and the Japanese contributed a radar and the launch.
Okay.
So this mission is now flying, and it provides information primarily on precipitation across the tropics and the mid-latitudes.
Predicting hurricanes, all that kind of stuff, which after last season we know is kind of a big deal.
That's right. We are we were just awarded a contract to build a similar mission for the Air Force. It's called Weather System Follow-On Microwave. And that mission is using a very similar technology. It measures the wind speed and direction at the ocean surface.
Can you hazard a guess as to why the Air Force would want to know that kind of stuff?
Right, well, that's a good question. So, for instance, we have U.S. military installations throughout the world. A lot of them are in areas which are vulnerable to tropical cyclones. And understanding the intensity and direction and timing of where tropical storms or typhoons are moving is very important for us to be able to, you know, stay ready as a military.
I am here with Claire Barcham, who is the Commercial Space Director for the UK Space Agency. I didn't even know they had one of those. That's pretty cool. Claire, it's so nice to meet you. I love your accent.
Thank you so much.
So, I gotta be honest. I didn't know that there was a UK space agency. What do you guys do?
So we've heard that a lot here, and we're really keen to promote ourselves. I would say that our ambition is probably a little bit bigger than our size at the moment. And what we do is set the government's policy for the civil use of space. So that means that we're responsible for how the UK uses space to promote our science and research activities, to promote our industry, to promote our commercial and economic interests. What we don't do is military. That's our Ministry
That's
of Defence colleagues.
So does the agency have plans to have their own launch vehicles? Are you going to use somebody else's?
What we're doing is a little bit different to some other countries. We're not saying that UK government is going to procure a launcher. We're not going to build our own and run our own spaceport. What we want to do is make sure that businesses that have plans to do that are able to in the UK. So we want to create an environment where commercial launch to orbit is really successful and thrives.
All right, so I have to ask this question. Being in London, you probably would know this if it's true or not. Is Big Ben actually a spaceship?
Well, if you have a look at, I don't know if you've seen the British TV show Doctor Who.
Yes.
A spaceship did crash into Big Ben on TV once. But no, I'm not aware that Big Ben is a spaceship. If it is, they've kept it a really
tight. So you can neither confirm nor deny.
Well, I'm not going to say that it's not.
I love you. All right, that was my Stevie Wonder. That was horrible. We have been at the 34th Annual Space Symposium, and it was awesome. We didn't see even a 16th of the people that were here, but I would like to say thank you so much to the people we did see and who put up with me, because you guys are awesome and you made this a really fun day. I'm going back into space. See ya. Oh, man. This is so awesome.